So this would serve as your foundational kickstart on one of the subsets of artificial intelligence and machine learning, which is about natural language processing. Now, we can say that this is a subfield because this is the field of AI that pertains to understanding and comprehending human language in general. Okay, so when we say also human language, remember that when we talk about human language, it doesn't just mean spoken text, right? It can also pertain to written text as well, you know? So I'm not sure if you can still recall in your English subjects back then, you know, but there are four skills in communication that an individual needs to develop, right? It is reading. So there are two passive skills wherein there is reading and listening. And finally, there is two active skills, which is writing and speaking. So NLP is covering these four. No? Essentially, what we're doing is teaching machines in order to gain these four skills. No? And it's through NLP. Now, in this session, no, we'll briefly discuss what is NLP in general as a science. We'll also identify some use cases wherein NLP is applicable as a use case, no? And quick jump into the last portion, no? You may be also wondering, sir, because we are dealing with Asia Open RAN and we are really primarily focused more on open radio access networks, no? How come? So there is still it's understandable that we can incorporate machine learning and AI as part of as a subfield supporting Open RAN. But how can we see the relationship between NLP and Open RAN? Is there even a relationship at all? So that is also one of the use cases that we would be briefly discussing here. Okay, then going back here, no, we'll also discuss, remember the four skills that I have mentioned on communication, wherein we have reading and listening and writing and speaking, no? In NLP, this actually covers two general umbrella terms, which is called natural language generation, which stands for the active skills that you need to learn, which is writing and speaking, and natural language understanding, which are your passive skills, no? Your reading and listening. And we'll briefly also discuss here the NLP pipeline. Remember that in your communications, no, by the way, just a caveat here, no, because we are dealing with communications, language, linguistics in general, no, you might also be encountering or expect that I would also be encountering or mentioning here also some terms that is related to that separate field of study, such as tokenization, lemmatization. These are primarily topics that is related to linguistics, but we'll also be tackling it here. No? Then we'll also briefly discuss what is a generative pre-trained transformer or GPT. So we'll also enumerate here the challenges faced by NLP. Because remember that like all sciences, this is also facing its own sets of limitations and challenges. I mean, right now, if you're going to also look at it, no, I'm sure everybody here has already experienced using either Google Gemini or Copilot or ChatGPT or any of the available chatbots available that is freely open right now to be used, no, albeit in different use cases. So we've noticed there that despite the chatbot's level of comprehension, no, there is still some quirks and bugs that these systems is still exhibiting. So it's still not yet there on achieving that perfect sense of as if we are talking to a human being, right? So that is also one of the items that we will be discussing. Okay. So I'll now proceed. What is NLP in general? No? So NLP, this is a subfield of artificial intelligence. So think of NLP as sort of like an overlap between AI as a science, also AI and machine learning with language or linguistics. So this is a subject that deals with the needing computers or machines to understand, manipulate, and generate human language. So we know that there are different aspects also of the human language, that it has a separate, or despite its complexity, no, there are, it deserves its own field of study, hence linguistics. Okay, so think of NLP as sort of like an application of linguistics in a computer science perspective, okay, wherein we use advanced technologies, including computational linguistics, machine learning, deep learning models, in order to process human language in various forms, no, from written to voice recordings. Okay, the goal of NLP is, like the goal of communications in general, is not just to grasp the meaning of individual words and groups of words, but also to allow the machine to comprehend speech patterns and give or to understand language context, intentions, and emotions. Right? Because it's not enough that you just write it down or to speak it. Sometimes it also depends on the context. Right? So we are allowing the machine to understand these nuances of the human language also in general. Okay, so like what I have mentioned, we can say that NLP in general is really sort of like an overlap between computer science and linguistics. Okay, so moving forward, no? Like also your machine learning, wherein you have different subfields and classifications. Remember that AI, no, it also has subfields that is somewhat related to mimicking or allowing the machine to mimic the aesthetics of the human body or how the body physiologically functions. That's where robotics would be coming in, right? We also have a subfield of AI that deals with giving the machine the ability to analyze and to comprehend data. This is where machine learning would come in, right? And we also have machine learning subsets such as deep learning, right? NLP also shares the same pattern, wherein it also has different subfields. And right now, we have two general subfields. This actually correlates to the four skills that I have mentioned on communication, okay? So, depending on how language is being comprehended and generated, no, NLP is also covering several topics, meaning this is where your chatbots would come in, no? Not necessarily lemmatization, because lemmatization is a part of the pipeline, no? Chatbots, word classification, text generation, machine translation. It can even overlap to speech recognition and even computer vision, especially in use cases wherein you have a machine that would use a camera and that camera is then used to detect text, no, using pictures, and from there identify which of these images it is able to capture are written text. So that is an overlap of NLP with computer vision. It also has speech recognition. In fact, if I'm not mistaken, I think it is not, I think it's not enabled here, no, right now, but I believe Zoom and some Microsoft Teams, if I'm not mistaken, no, already has AI generated or AI powered tools inside of it, or apps that allow the model to pick up what the user or who is currently speaking right now in a Zoom call, no, and able to transcribe those, you know, those texts, no, depending on the language, of course. No? So that is also an overlap of NLP with speech recognition, because it's able to convert speech to text, no, and from there summarize what it was able to capture. Okay, so other subfields of NLP, no, much like AI in general, can also overlap with what I have mentioned, no. But in terms of how it overlaps with AI, no, most of the time it still deals with machine learning in general. Remember that if you're going to look at it from, say, a common sense perspective, no, I cannot find a much better word for it, no, but if you're going to look at it at common sense, no, before you can before the hum before a person is able to speak or to listen, no, or between those steps, no, of course the mind is still involved. It's able to analyze it. We may not be able to subconsciously be made aware of it, but every time, say, we hear certain words or phrases, no, we are subconsciously already analyzing what we have heard, or if we're trying to read something, no, we are already trying to comprehend what we are currently reading. What's my point here, no? NLP can also overlap, in fact, most of the times, with machine learning, right? Think of machine learning as sort of like the part of your pipeline responsible for analyzing the text that NLP is able to receive, right? Or the voice that it is able to accept. Okay? So, what are the different use cases for NLP in general? So, we also have several. No? First off, under communication and interaction, in fact, this is the most obvious use cases. No? There are virtual assistants, chatbots, no? And even machine translation. NLP, in fact, has already been there, like machine learning, for quite some time. Even, in fact, even before the popularity of ChatGPT, no, the chatbots in general, no, there are already use cases available for us. And in fact, no, we haven't yet given much attention to it, but just an example, Google Translate is an example of an NLP use case, right? That's one. Even before ChatGPT became a thing, no, there are already existing virtual assistants residing in our mobile phones, right? If you have Apple iOS, it would consist of you have your Siri, right? If you have Amazon, you already have Alexa, right? So these are already at play. Other use cases would involve, this is the most arguably the use case that is gaining popularity nowadays, which is content creation and automation. Communication and interaction has already been there, but quote unquote, the next new thing in AI is actually content creation and automation, wherein we are giving already the machines the ability to predict text, meaning that you give it a prompt and immediately it is able to generate text based on that prompt. We also have filtering and content generation. And content here doesn't just refer to written content, but it can also be visual and in some cases, audio content. I have yet to see a voice generated GPT by, but I think there is already a use case available right now. Right? And lastly, last use case is of course information retrieval and analysis. In my opinion, no, out of the three classification or the three use case classifications that NLP has right now, no, the quote unquote the oldest one, in fact, is information retrieval and analysis, because that is also the most ready-made available use case for NLP, no, in general. Even before machine learning became a thing, NLP was already using use cases for information retrieval and analysis, such as search engines. So imagine that Googling is already an NLP use case on its own. Okay, text summarization and sentiment analysis, these are more relatively popular use cases, but in fact, companies have already been using these two for especially marketing and advertising purposes. Because remember that every time you say a drop, every time you drop comment or feedback to say a product that you have recently purchased, no, that is already sentiment analysis. It might not be that sentiment analysis is being done quote unquote manually, meaning it is able to, we are already quantifying or giving a certain specific value based on what a review has been given, but it's already there. It's just a matter of implementing it using machine learning. What the use case that is more relatively new, albeit in my opinion nowadays, is in fact implementing these different use cases with machine learning and deep learning. Okay. Now, what are the different tasks that NLP would involve? No, we have here three in general. And again, I go back to the four skills that I have mentioned on communication because it also pertains to these three tasks. No? So NLP, understanding, this equips computers and machines with the ability to process and comprehend the meaning of human language, including spoken and written text. Okay. Manipulation, this allows computers to modify and work with human language in various ways. When we say manipulation, this is where summarization would also be coming in. Sentiment analysis would be coming in. Classification or classifiers would also fall in this portion. Essentially, you are giving the machine some text, and through that written text, allow the machine to make sense of what those written texts or spoken text really is. Right, so you're trying to manipulate it, or you're trying to include analytics to it. So that's manipulation. And finally, generation. No, this empowers computers to create human-like text, or to use text, or create other forms of media or context, such as documents, images, speech, and even audio. Okay, so this is the task that is more popular nowadays. So imagine, no, in chat GPT, for example, you type there a prompt of create an image of the solar system, for instance. So that is already text generation. Okay. Now, in understanding, so some of these I have already specified, no? So for example, sentiment analysis. So what is it? It is a subfield of NLP that involves giving the computer or a machine the capability to identify emotional tones of a given message. In other words, you are giving the machine the ability to quantify a given sentence or a paragraph or a piece of text, no? And assigning it with a given score. Normally, in sentiment analysis, no, it would just involve three categories wherein it would tag text based on whether it is it positive, neutral, or negative. But it can also pertain to identifying the possible emotion driven by that given text. No? So you'll notice now that sentiment analysis, in terms of its use cases, normally this is used in quantifying, say, use case reviews of a given product. Okay, another one is named entity recognition. This gives the machine the ability to recognize and classify text based on entities within that set text. And when we say entities, it can, well, again, in language, so normally this is where your proper nouns would be coming in, right? But it's not just enclosed into proper nouns. It still depends on what you are trying to extract from your given text. So for example here, no, if I say input a specific sentence that includes some keywords, the machine is able to identify those keywords, right? And not only that, give it a high-level classification or a label. So that is NAR. And finally, machine translation. Translation here pertains to converting one language into another language. So for example, I have written something in Japanese, it is able to convert it into English. Google Translate, in other words. Okay? Now, for manipulation, this is also three, right? So summarization, I've already included here, condensing large pieces of text into shorter summaries while still retaining key information. No? In summarization, this also involves named entity recognition, wherein you're trying to identify some keywords and from there, no, try to shorten or to look into, depending on the other text that is around that given keyword, no? Look into simplified words or summarized words in order to compress a paragraph, for instance, no? Into its shorter form. So that is text summarization. Question answering, Q&A. So this is extracting answers to questions posed in natural language from a given data set. This is where chatbots would be coming in. So for example, a user typed a specific question. Normally, in question answering, no, of course, you need a background or a database of knowledge that the machine is able to refer to. And in NLP, this refers to the corpus. The corpus is being referred to by the model in order to comprehend or to find keywords that would look up within its corpus and from there, generate a result. So if you're going to think about it, the Q&A capability of an NLP is more of like just giving the machine, or it's technically like the machine referring to a database, okay, based on what you are trying to query from that database. Okay, so it's just a repackaged, quote-unquote, repackaged or lemmatized version of database query. Okay. And lastly, this is paraphrasing. So we know what's the difference between summarization and paraphrasing, right? So it's like rewording or finding similar words on a given sentence and in a way, paraphrase it, no? But still retaining its overall context and meaning, right? So for example, you write out or it technically, no, this is different from translation, because in machine translation, you are converting one language into a different language. In paraphrasing, you're essentially still working on the same language, but you're trying to reword it in a different way. So an example here, I believe if you are familiar with, I'm not sure if you have heard of Quillbot, no? So that is actually an AI tool used by researchers in academics. No? They have the capability of understanding or rephrasing a given sentence based on whether is it casual or do you want it to be scientific or do you want it to be academic, right? So that is paraphrasing. Okay. Then last task involves generation. So this is also three. You'll notice that chatbots, this is where it would fall. So simulating conversation with humans through text or voice interactions. Okay. Another one is machine writing. So if we have machine translation that deals with translating one language into another, machine language, this is more applicable to developers. Copilot, in fact, is an example of a tool, no, wherein the machine automatically generates different creative text formats like poetry, code, scripts, or musical pieces. So Copilot here is an example because you just type it with a prompt. So say, for example, if you are writing Python code, no, write the Python code for displaying Hello World, the machine is able to give to you the equivalent code based on your prompt. Okay, and lastly, text-to-speech synthesis. This is, in my opinion, one of the older applications of NLP. Well, I don't want to say older, but the earliest forms of NLP, no? Wherein we are converting written text into spoken language and even vice versa, which is speech-to-text synthesis. Okay, Alexa and Siri are examples of here, or even Hey Google would also fall in this category. Okay, any questions so far? Still good? Okay, so I hope my pace is not even that fast, eh, no? Okay, now, NLP, because it consists of, again, the four communications, it deals with active and passive skills, no, NLP has its own equivalent of it, which is natural language understanding, which is equivalent to your passive skills, and natural language generation, which is your active skills. Okay, now NLU, no, so think of NLP as sort of like a formula already, because it consists of these two studies or applications, no. So what is NLU? This is natural language understanding. This is a subset of NLP which uses syntactic and semantic analysis of text in order to determine the meaning and context of a sentence. It mostly focuses on the machine's ability to understand written or spoken text. Okay? So as an example here, no? This is also where just having the word is not enough, meaning that you just assign a given word its definition, because you also need to understand its underlying context. So just for example, you know, so say we know the word key, right? But it can have several meanings based on the context, on where, which part of the sentence it is being used, right? So in NLU, you are giving the machine the ability to comprehend this, no? So for example, here, no, the key to the castle has been lost. So we know here that the word key here stands for the noun, the key or the key, okay? So say, in other words, no? But taken from a different sentence, for example, the general played a key role in making the campaign a success. The word key here doesn't correspond to Suse anymore in Filipino, right? So here, the general played a key role. So here, the word role stands as the noun, no? And key here is being used by as an adjective, right? So that is where NLU would really be coming in. And lastly, no, last example, the guardsman locked the door, keying it shut. You'll notice that key here is still being used in a different way, but this time it is being used as an adverb in order to describe how the door, which is your noun, is locked. Okay? Actually, locked the door. Locked here is your verb, not your noun. Okay? So NLU is giving the capability to the machine to understand also whether a given word is a noun, an adjective, or an adverb, or something else. Okay? Now, the other side of the coin, natural language generation. So this is the subset of NLP which involves producing human text based on a given prompt or based on some data input. Okay? This can also involve several steps, which is text planning, sentence planning, and even realization. So how do we go about it? Well, suppose, say, you prompt the machine to write a simple sentence. Okay, it may sound, quote-unquote, also simple to us to understand, no? But at the back end, no, it involves several steps, no? First off, no, just take note also that NLG is also hand in hand with NLU, okay? Because remember that before the machine is able to generate text, it also needs to have the ability to understand it first, right? So meaning, just this simple sentence, no? At the back, the machine is already capable of, first off, understanding or categorizing it based on what language is it? Is it English? Is it Filipino? Is it Japanese or something else? From there, it is also able to plan out a sentence based on a given prompt, right? It also needs to also understand how the given words are being used in your sentence. Okay, and finally, realization here involves already completely structuring out the sentence altogether. So imagine, no, it consists of several steps, no, just for NLG generation, but we are completely transparent of these given steps, no? And I mean, despite its nuances, no, it gives the machine the perceived notion that it is able to quote unquote understand what the prompt it has received. Okay? So, NLP, remember that right now or nowadays, no, it is a, or it overlaps with machine learning. Right? So remember our discussion about what ML is, no, what is AI in general, and also deep learning. You can apply NLP using also the tools that you will learn in machine learning in general, meaning that you create your model. No, the only difference here is that the model that you'll be creating is intended to run in order to comprehend human text. Right, but again, you can create models, no, deep learning models, or even simple models or machine learning models, no, in order to create an NLP system. A chatbot, actually, in fact, is the simplest application for it. Okay, so again, because machine learning depends on data, also the workflow of how you get your data and process your data is also the same for NLP. In other words, there would still be involving data preparation, AI modeling or model creation, no, system designing, and finally deployment. Okay? So these are things that we have already discussed before. Okay? So now, NLP as a science, it consists of several steps. Although unconsciously, we are already generating text, no, based on, I mean, we're not really much thinking about it on, say, especially if we are using our native tongue, such as for English or even Filipino. It's the process on how we do this is actually already subconsciously free-flowing in a way. No? But it still pays to give proper labels, no, and distinctions on how does a machine able to comprehend human text. No? So it involves several steps. And it involves these ones. In fact, we'll briefly go through them one by one. No? Now, the color coding here is also nuanced. Keep that in mind. So NLP pipeline as a process in general, it consists of 7 steps, okay? But you'll notice that the ones that are in red, no, in some sources, these are what you would call the required steps, right? Whereas the first two, so the sentence segmentation and dependency parsing, these steps normally overlap also to the other required steps. So just keep this in mind, no? What are these, no? Okay, so this is the comments that I have mentioned. In some sources, these are the basic steps for NLP, the ones that are in red. No, notice that machine learning can already be applied here such that the models would be able to implement these steps, no, as processes inside of it. Okay, and in fact, if you are familiar with Python code, no, specifically using the NLPK module, Natural Language Toolkit module, you're able to, or each of these steps has its own function, and it's just a matter of just calling these functions. Okay, so I'll briefly describe also what are these steps now. So first off, sentence segmentation. So this normally also pertains, or this step is normally involved if the input text that you have given consists of not just one sentence. Okay, this involves dividing the entire paragraph into different sentences for better understanding. Now, you might be wondering, no, sir, isn't this a bit too oversimplified as a step? Yes and no. Okay, because for us, especially for those who are, say, using the Latin alphabet, no, we use the period in order to delimit our text. But in some languages and in some cultures, no, they do not use the period in order to terminate a given sentence. Okay, in fact, the older alphabet that we are using, no, if you're familiar with Baybayin, no, the alphabet that we have used even before the Spaniards came, no? It is delimited using a bar line. Okay? So it's not a period. And if you are also familiar with, say, Proto-Germanic languages such as runes, the ones that are used in, or the Elder Futhark, that one that we have mentioned, no, they are using bars and colons in order to terminate the text. They use bars in order to space out the words, no. They use double bars with colons in order to terminate a sentence. So sentence segmentation is still crucial. It still depends on the language. So in more modern examples here also, no, Japanese does not use the period that we are normally using, no. If you'll check, no, the period the Japanese use is a small circle, okay, or a small encircle, no, but it's technically a period per se, but you'll notice that how it is written out, it's different. Okay, so the point here is that these steps or this specific step involves segmenting or partitioning a given paragraph into its smaller parts. Okay, so for example, I have here this text that was taken from Wikipedia. No, what is London? No? It is split into three sentences using the period as its segmentation or delimiter. Okay, so after chopping it into paragraphs, what's the next step? You chop it now into different words. Okay, so this is called tokenization. Now, this step breaks the sentence into separate words or tokens. Now, depending also on what a token is, it can refer to a word or a phrase, and in some cases, even characters. Okay? So this helps the context of the text, no? To give more understanding on what the text really is. When tokenizing the sentence, it is broken into separate words or phrases based on the model's set threshold. Similar also to sentence segmentation, you further break down that sentence into its smaller parts called tokens. Okay? Now, in most functions or in most languages, no? Language here that I'm pertaining to is programming language. A token can be already words in itself. Okay? But notice that a token doesn't just constitute, or you don't just use, for example, in the English language, no? We use spaces in order to distinguish one word from the other, no? A token can also consist of several words based on the context or threshold that you have set into the model. So, for example, here, if I take one sentence, London's the capital and most populous city of England and the United Kingdom, no? Some of the tokens here can be on a percent or on a per word basis. But take note that there are also some tokens that would consist of two words, such as United Kingdom. You don't take it United and Kingdom. Okay, you take it as just one word, no? Okay, so that's how tokenization works. Now, after we have broken down, so from sentence, we've broken it into, oh, sorry, from a paragraph, we've broken it into a sentence, into sentences. From sentences, we've broken it down into context, to tokens. The next step now is to giving already, this is where the comprehension would now come in. Okay, so stemming, it involves in pre-processing. This, the model is then allowed to analyze the parts of the speech in order to figure out what exactly the sentence is talking about. In other words, you are giving the machine the capability to comprehend what those tokens actually mean based on how they are used, no? Stemming normally involves getting the base or root form of a given word. Okay, this is also important when we are now trying to understand the tense of a given word. Normally applies into verbs, for instance. Okay, so here's an example on how stemming would work, no? So let's take one example, which is London. Let's take this as our token. Now, in our or in the previous slide, no, we've noticed that London, the token London is followed by is, right? So meaning that it is followed by is the capital, no? So in terms of how it is placed, no, in your sentence, and referring again to the English language, no, we can pass this into a model and able to identify that the word London is actually pertaining to a proper noun. So this is an example of stemming. You get the root form. I mean, there's no such thing as lon and don, right? You take it as it's one straight word as London. So that is stemming. Now, the next step, lemmatization, is already, so here is an example already of stemming. Now, you essentially give each of the tokens a specific label on how it is used in a sentence, no? And the order on how it is used in your sentence. Okay? Now, next one is lemmatization. Now, lemmatization came from the word lemma, or getting the canonical form of a word. If stemming involves getting the stem or the base root of a given word, lemmatization involves getting the lemma or the canonical form. So as an example, no, let's take London again as our token, no. We do not, or what is London's lemma in a way? It's not done. We do not remove the first word. We do not remove the prefix or suffix, no? We treat it as is London, right? So lemmatization, when we refer to the canonical form, especially in English, no, you'll notice that there are some words that we add prefixes or suffixes to it. I mean, the word itself already, lemmatization, as an example, we know that the word zation, this is the suffix that refers to or that we connect to the word lemma. Okay, so we can say that lemma is the canonical form of lemmatization. Similar also for London, no? London, you do not remove the prefix or suffix or any part of the word itself. We retain the word as it is, as its lemma. Okay, so for another example here, no? We don't just involve in lemmatization removing any possible prefixes or suffixes into the given text. It can also refer to understanding how the word is used in the sentence. That is also lemma. Okay? So, for example, we know that capital can consist of several meanings, right? It can refer to an adjective, which is meaning best or top, superior, okay, meaning the capital expenses, for instance. Okay, so the top expenses that we need to look into. Actually, the one that I am referring to is also the word capital used in the context of accounting or money, which is something that we do not also want. Okay, in the sentence, the word capital here is actually pertaining to metropolis or municipality. In other words, it is a location. Okay, so lemmatization, in fact, involves associating the correct form of the word, okay, based on two things: its overall context, and also after removing any prefixes or suffixes within that given word. Okay, so next one, stop word analysis. So this is further broken down. So after we have, again, no, stop word analysis is also dependent on word tokenization, such as stemming and similar to stemming and lemmatization, wherein you now try to filter out any of the stop words used in the sentence. Okay? So what are stop words? This can often involve articles or decorators in the sentence, such as prepositions or conjunctions. So in, the, a, of, okay? These are filtered out, okay, in order to just get the key tokens that is referred to. Okay, this is not to say that we are removing the stop words altogether. This is just, again, similar to what we have done in stemming, wherein we add labels to it. We just need to identify, okay, because these are words that are stop words, are they necessary for the model to completely comprehend what the sentence is trying to talk to? Okay. So we're just essentially adding a label to it. Okay. So example here, no, we've done this one during the step of stemming. No, after stop word analysis, we are just further filtering out any of the important words or tokens that the model needs to properly tag. No, this is also the step that is, in my opinion, no, important for text classification. Because remember that in what I have discussed a while ago, no, text classification is used to label the parts of your sentence wherein you are more interested in. Stop word analysis is needed. Okay, so next, dependency parsing. So this is mainly used to find out how all of the words in a sentence are related to each other. So we have already labeled them. The next step is then identifying how are they related to each other. Okay, to find the dependency, a tree is logically created and assigned with a single word as a parent word. Now, normally this word is chosen randomly. No, in English languages, normally this is where your subject word would be coming in. The main verb in the sentence will also act as the noun. So, for example, here, no. So again, this is just an illustration on how it is being done. Of course, depending on how a model is implemented based on the programming language, no, dependency parsing can also be laid out differently. Okay. So in some steps also, dependency parsing is also included as a step in the part of speech tagging. So what is it, no? This involves the process of assigning grammatical labels or tags to each word in a sentence. So it is different from stemming, such that apart from just identifying or labeling each of the different words or tokens in your sentence, you also need to and understand how is it being used in a sentence, right? So for example here, no, London, oh no, we know that it is a proper noun. How is it being used, right? In English, normally a noun can be the subject or the object. In our example here, London is being used as the subject, okay? Then what are the other objects found inside your sentences? No, we have city, okay, which is actually an object pertaining to London, which is your subject, okay, and it is being modified using an adjective, which is populous, okay? So part of speech tagging, in other words, you're trying to identify which of these tokens is your subject, which one of this is your verb, which one of this is your object, etc. Okay, so fortunately for us, no, these steps in our pipeline already exist as functions, no, especially if you're familiar with Python, no, because these can be in fact implemented already just by calling a specific function in your script. Now, one of the use cases that is has already gained popularity nowadays, no, is the development of a GPT. Or generative pre-trained transformer. This, in fact, was first developed. A GPT was first developed by OpenAI. I believe you are already familiar on the company itself. Now, this is the company who also introduced ChatGPT. Okay? But what is it? This is a prominent language framework that normally deals with generative AI. Okay, and it can arguably be mentioned, or it can arguably be said that this is an implementation of what's called a large language model. Okay, a GPT is in fact a language model implemented using ANN as its framework. Okay, it is not like your, for example, your simple linear regression model, where it just consists of one layer and then you give it an input and then out comes the output in the form of, say, a calculation. No? A large language model is more complex than that. Okay, this is also why you as eventually, you know, if you have plans on say developing your own chatbots, no, or language systems, large language model systems, no, you don't necessarily need to download or to develop a large language model from scratch. Normally, there are already available frameworks, no, or pre-trained language models that you as a developer just need to call on. If you want to pursue a path, or if you want to pursue or create your own GPT, in fact, you can also do so. But majority of us who are not really much into the computer science field, no, and it's just a matter of just incorporating a GPT into our workflow, for instance. You don't need to develop it from scratch. Okay? You just need to call a certain function out of it. Okay? So some chatbots that are normally available right now is the ones that we are seeing here now. So we have here OpenAI, which was developed using ChatGPT. Actually, the ChatGPT, Gemini, and Claude, no, these are what you would call chatbots. This is the front end of your GPT, of your language model. But what you're referring to, or the underlying logic of it, is the large language model itself, the LLM. This is where GPT is. So notice the distinction between ChatGPT, the chatbot, and the large language model it uses at the back end. So in this case, OpenAI already has GPT-4. I believe GPT-4 is the latest version, no? Then you also have 3.5. Now, other companies have also developed their own large language models for us to use. For example, Google uses Palm, okay? And its front, it's Google Gemini. And I sorry about Anthropic, I haven't heard of this one. It uses Claude 2, and its chatbot is front is Claude, no? There is also the large language model called BERT, if I'm not mistaken, BERT. This is, I believe, an open source large language model used by frameworks such as Hugging Face. So I'm not kidding. Hugging Face is also a company. You can also look this one up. Hugging Face and TensorFlow, okay, as an example. Now, GPT has its several also characteristics. As mentioned, this is an implementation of an ANN, so meaning it uses a neural network as its underlying architecture. Okay? A GPT is also pre-trained. In other words, if you want to incorporate it as part of your workflow, you just call it based on who is offering that GPT. So based on the examples that I have mentioned a while ago, pre-trained here refers to you don't remember that we have a machine model, right? And you need sample data in order to train it first, no, before it can produce a result. Fortunately for us as end users, no, we just need to call that GPT model for it to be used. We don't necessarily need to train it already. We can optimize the training based on the requirement that we need, no? But a generic pre-trained model is already available for us to download. Okay? And in terms of its use case, a GPT is normally applied to an NLG use case wherein it has generative capabilities. Normally, this is used as as your underlying logic for your chatbot. No, so as the name suggests, this is a generative model. It generates content. Okay, so what are the different challenges of NLP? So I was able to note down here four from the source that I got from Meta Dialogue. No? So like machine learning, NLP also faces challenges in ambiguity and vagueness. So the human language is nuanced, to say the least. It's very nuanced. So meaning that there is already some opportunities of ambiguity that a machine model can encounter. So that's one. Another one, language transition. Okay, it is challenging for NLP systems to stay current and handle new language appropriately. This is also one of the challenges faced by models pertaining to pop culture. Right? So as an example, no? So say you have a your own example, your own GPT, no, or your own chatbot, and you say it or you ask it, what is GOAT? So of course, no, it would refer to the goat as an animal, but you're actually referring to it as a acronym, GOAT. So remember, GOAT back then was a thing in Gen Z era, if I'm not mistaken, no. And we know that this is an acronym for greatest of all time. Another example here, no. Try to ask it, what is the Lulu? Okay. So if you are not into the Gen Z speak, you won't even know what the Lulu is, right? But it stands for delusional, right? So this is a challenge that NLP is facing. Okay. And lastly is, actually, this is just three of the seven that was identified by MetaDialogue, no? But I just focus on the three important ones, no? Figures of speech, sarcasm, irony, and idiomatic expressions, right? So depending also in if a model is not trained enough to capture irony, okay, or idiomatic expressions, it can often take a sentence literally. Okay, so example here, no, she's cold with her words today. So if you're familiar with the word or how cold here is being used, you're pretending to distant or unemotional, right? But the model can pertain this one to be literally cold, such as below temperature, and it might have a different prompt altogether, right? It can even take emojis, no, and based on these emojis out of context, spew out a different interpretation. So this is also a challenge, right? So language itself as a study continues to grow, expand, no, and evolve in time. Some words that we don't necessarily use already are being used nowadays, and even vice versa. I mean, the word selfie wasn't a word back then, but here you go, right? So it's also the challenge of NLP to keep up to date on these nuances in language in general. Okay, so on the last part, no, so I now go into the argument of, okay, we have NLP. How is it being used in Open RAN in general? So here's my own proposition. No, remember that Open RAN as a science, this doesn't just pertain to the radio access network or the network that is found at the back, right, or at the back end. And when I'm referring to the back end, we're pertaining to the network in general. It can also cover use cases that is more customer facing. In other words, use cases that would involve human interactivity. Okay, so how can we, or what do we personally propose for NLP to be used for Open RAN? So by the way, these are ones that we are proposing as an organization, no? So first off, chatbots and virtual assistants, no? NLP can allow telecommunication companies to develop chatbots that can answer customer questions and troubleshoot problems. I believe not just for telcos, but even in other companies in general. Right? I mean, for example, for Globe, we have Ask G, right? Or for banking, for instance, we have Bea, for instance. Okay, they have their own chatbots for self-troubleshooting or self-help. So it removes a bit of a burden away from operators in order to seek out some simple tasks that the customer can already work out on their own. But if we're going to look at it from a realistic perspective nowadays, some of the issues that we encounter, no, are a bit nuanced, such that a chatbot is often not enough, right? So this is where already human intervention would be coming in. So that's one use case. Another use case, network operations and maintenance. While most operations and monitoring systems are point and click based, imagine a system wherein you have a ChatGPT-like prompt in your optimization tool You just type it what you want, and immediately that network is able to implement what you type. So, for example, instead of accessing a UI, and that UI is you use it to point and click configurations, no? You just type a simple text like optimize my network or optimize Gnode B XYZ by tilting its antenna to X number of degrees. So a text-based prompt, and immediately the system is able to identify that prompt and do the necessary configurations, no, without you as the end user raising a point and click action, no. So that's another example. And lastly, the most important, albeit the most important use case is cybersecurity. NLP can be a tool to enhance cybersecurity, wherein you now use text classification, sentiment analysis, no, and even naming entity recognition in order to filter out any spam, phishing, no, threats while it is being worked on in the network. So take note that NLP doesn't just involve human interaction in a way that you have a Q&A engagement with a chatbot. NLP can also involve analyzing the text. And normally these texts can also be found in emails, no, messages, broadcasts, texts, etc. Okay, so these are just a few of the use cases that we can actually implement. Okay? And actually that's it, no? We've covered a lot in a span of an hour or so, no? So just to give you a quick recap on what NLP is, no? So again, this is a subfield of AI that deals with giving the machine the capability to understand and to generate human text based on human language. Okay? We also discussed here several use cases of NLP, and the two main studies of NLP is natural language understanding and generation. Okay? We also discussed the 7 steps of an NLP pipeline. Two of them, sentence segmentation and dependency parsing, can already be incorporated as parts of other steps such as tokenization, stemming lemmatization, stop point analysis, and part of speech tagging. We also briefly discussed what is a GPT in general. So we know that this is a model that was created first by OpenAI and eventually gained popularity through its chatbots. Okay? While NLP may offer several advantages, it also faces its own challenges and limitations due to the complexity of the human language in general. Okay. And finally, no, human interactivity and human-to-machine communication can go beyond consumer-level use cases, as NLP can even be used for telecommunications, such as chatbots, no, cybersecurity, and what's the last one? I forgot. Cybersecurity, chatbots, and network operations and maintenance.